Good afternoon. My name is Rich Grevens, theology teacher and coordinator of theology outreach and conferences at Archbishop McCarthy High School. Welcome to the third of five installments of McCarthy High School's third annual Spring Speaker Series. The past 2 years, we've brought in prominent Catholic scholars, authors, and speakers to our community to enlighten us on a wide variety of topics to help us grow in knowledge and love of the faith. We happily continue this tradition again this year on campus. This afternoon's presenter is Dr. Francisco Castillo. His presentation is entitled The Catholic School as an Ecclesial Entity. Dr. Castillo will speak about the primary role of a Catholic school, that is, to form young persons in the faith. All aspects of the school, curricular design, athletic competition, prayer and liturgical life, retreats, service, learning, etc., should be oriented to this one goal. Francisco Castillo Demin is an adjunct professor in the Theology Philosophy Department at Barry University. He worked for 13 years as a Catholic educator for the Archdiocese of Miami, teaching high school and serving as Theology Department Chair and Director of Campus Ministry. He is a member of the Academy of Catholic Hispanic Theologians of the United States, a member of the National Hispanic Institute of Liturgy, and Scala, Sociedad de Catequetas Latinoamericanos. That's not to do with my stuff. His professional interests include the Catholic social thought, liturgical theology, liturgical and theological aesthetics, liberation theology, U.S. Hispanic, Latino, Latina theology, religious studies, comparative religion, religion and film, and cultural identity. He is also a writer and poet. He lives in South Florida with his wife and son. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions, to meet with our presenter personally at the end of the talk. And now, please welcome Dr. Francisco Castillo.
Thank you very much. I almost took this personally because I was invited last year and it didn't happen because of COVID. And I thought it was gonna happen this year because of the technology issues. I said, man, I guess you guys don't want me here. But thank you, I'm glad for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here. I feel like this is a sort of a coming home again for me. As you know, I was working here since 1999 to 2012, and then I moved on to Catholic Publishing. So I'm going to offer my perspective on what I call the Catholic High School as an ecclesial entity. And then I'm going to be asking questions, rhetorical questions, some of them. And I have some reflection questions that hopefully we can dialogue, we can make this into a dialogue. But let me start first by saying a story, tell you a story. In the campus ministry office that we had here, I had a poster that, this exact poster from the Coalition of Homeless, and it posed this question. It said, how can you worship a homeless man?
You lose everything?
How can you worship a homeless man on Sunday and ignore one on Monday? And the question, the poster raised a great deal of questions, mainly from people that would ask you what that meant. What is the meaning of that? How can you worship a homeless man on Sunday and ignore one on Monday? And what I used to tell people is, well, what does it mean to you? But then I started thinking that perhaps it wasn't evident, or as evident as I thought, that there is a connection between liturgy and ethics. In other words, prayer and action. So I offer to you the liturgy as that interpretive key, as the hermeneutical key, as I'm calling it, to understand what it is that we do here in a Catholic high school. And before I tell you about why I think the liturgy should be the center of everything that we do here. When I was thinking about this project, someone that I respect a lot sent me the following message and said, Frank, my suggestion is that you think and pray. I think the idea is a great one. I do have some questions about whether or not the liturgy is the ideal way to catechize or evangelize at the high school level. Though especially since those who might be the most effective evangelizers are not allowed to be celebrants or preachers.
In other words, they don't have any agency in the region. And I found that to be very interesting in the sense that what I'm here to propose to you is this idea that the liturgy is about everything that we should be doing in a Catholic school. That the liturgy is everything that we should be doing in a Catholic school, because the liturgy, very poetically defined, says it is a divine human exchange, a dialogue, a conversation between God and the human person. Okay? And that conversation prompts the believer into action. That's how I see the liturgy. It's an exchange, it's a give and take, a conversation, a dialogue. Okay? And so that's why I believe that we can use it as that key to see everything that we're doing. And if you don't believe me, this is what your diocese of Miami says.
And I'm going to read this to you.
An atmosphere of Catholic values and traditions permeates the schools. Paths of instruction in the Catholic faith, prayer experiences, liturgy, and retreat experiences offer students an opportunity to establish a personal relationship with God. Catholic tradition of good works is emphasized through required service hours and charitable projects. The Archdiocese believes that faith can be strengthened through education. And I like that last sentence because notice that it doesn't say that education can be strengthened through faith, but that faith can be strengthened through education. There is a Irish saying that says, the arrow that is pointed to the head will never pierce the heart. And to me, if we are not aiming towards the students' hearts, just to the head, we're not doing anything at all. We're not doing anything at all. So to me, that the idea that faith can be strengthened through education is also central to what I am going to try to convey to you today. Now, that's the Archdiocese of Miami. What about Archbishop McCarthy High School? Well, Archbishop McCarthy High School has this beautiful motto that says, Manere Intellectione Christi, which means, roughly translated, to abide in the love of Christ. And this is what Archbishop McCarthy High School claims to do. Okay? Through 40 years of academic instruction, an invitation to participate in campus ministry, extracurricular activities, sports, academic classes are offered by semester, which allows a variety of diverse perspectives, and students are invited to participate in service projects and retreats, and this exposes them to Christ proclaimed. Okay? And by the Christian community, the witness of the instructors and the administration, parents, and their peers. So this is a very ambitious goal that Archbishop McCarthy High School has, but I think you guys, teachers, parents, administrators, students, you are accomplishing it. You are accomplishing it. Because what does it mean to be exposed to the proclamation of the Christian community? Well, the Christian community is every single member of the school, all the stakeholders of Archbishop McCarthy High School are charged with the task of proclaiming the good news. And how does that happen? Well, the United States Conference of Bishops says that the Catholic high schools provide concrete explorations of the faith in the process of conversion. So how do we explore the faith? And here I'm speaking to the faculty, to the administration, because the exploration of the faith doesn't only happen in the theology classroom, but it happens in every classroom. Because the invitation is for every single one of us to be parents, teachers, administrators, students, to be proclaimers of that word, and to explore it in the classroom, in social studies, in history, in economics, in government class, in science, in the English department, in the foreign language department, or what's it called now, world something?
World
languages. Okay? So we are called there to explore the faith. But before you explore it, it has to be proclaimed. It has to be proclaimed. Now, why am I calling it an ecclesial entity? An ecclesial entity in the sense that it's part of what we do in the church. Now, ecclesia is the Greek word for church, which probably comes from the Hebrew term, the kahal. The kahal is, roughly translated, the calling, the summon. I like the word invitation better. And I probably stole this from Karl Rahner, who says that the faith is an invitation sent to us by God, and that actually our response to God is what faith is all about. So in other words, God calls us, God invites us into a community. So ecclesia is that gathering, that assembly. Okay, so you'll often hear me talk about the term assembly, the gathering. And what I'm proposing to you is that the liturgy symbolizes that. All of us together, hearing God's word, answering God's invitation, exploring the faith, celebrating it, and then putting it into action. Okay, so that's what I mean an ecclesial institute. I'm sorry the screen is up, but I have some questions, some reflection questions that I want you to consider. And they could be rhetorical, or we could make it into a dialogue. What do you think is the primary role of a Catholic high school? What is your understanding of the liturgy? And the third question, what is the relationship of the liturgy to the Catholic high school or high school's overall program? So how are the two related? What is the primary role of the Catholic school? What is your understanding of liturgy? And how, in your understanding, are the two related? I'm not just talking to theology teachers, I'm talking to parents, I'm talking to people from different departments, to administrators. Okay, so how do you see the primary role? Anyway,
so first I said I was gonna ask you to sit here so I can ask you questions.
So, and do you see, does anybody see a connection between the two? The liturgy and the high school program, what we do as a high school? Dr. Diaz.
Well, the aim is the forming and informing people for mission.
Okay.
Right. Forming people is for forming mission. Is both forming and informing.
Okay.
And it's sort of the idea of that quote from the vision is about that education, that faith is strengthened through education. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if we understand by our council, the church is capable of and how are we forming them and informing them to be able to have that response within their own context?
Right.
Now, as far as liturgy is concerned, I see where you're saying that liturgy takes a role in informing. The challenge for that is how do you get the participants to accept symbols become meaningful for them and empowering for them.
Thank you. That is an excellent question about the symbols that are used in liturgy, because I do believe that we as a community of learners, instructors, we have those symbols. And I'm referring it to you because I know you've done some work on the impact of the digital world and technology, and you've written about that. But I always said this generation should understand the idea of what it is to mediate something through symbols. That's what technology is all about, is the mediation of knowledge. So you're asking a great question for me, and I do think, but there's something that we as a community of educators are not getting across to the community of learners.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll say a little bit about that. And I'll also say a little bit about the idea of what it is to be in a diverse environment as the one that we are. So why is there an ecclesial entity? Well, and this is my image of the gathered assembly, the liturgy. Okay? The community participates in the one prayer, in the one worship,
to the one, and the one church to the one God. Okay? So to me, that epitomizes everything that we do. And that's what I am trying to convey to you, is that we need to all of us understand that we are one. The high school, when we are gathering in liturgy, at prayer, we are part of the one church, worshiping the one God. And to me, that is it. That is the crux of everything that we're trying to say. It's up on that screen over there, but not here. Okay? So, liturgy, the celebration of is essential to the Catholic faith. Community means students, faculty, administration, and staff. We assemble for what? We assemble to proclaim the faith, to express our belief. So, given the fact that we cannot meet on a Sunday when the rest of the church meets, we cannot meet on Sundays, well, my proposal to Catholic educators is, how do we reconcile the academic year and the liturgical year? Then why is that important? Why is that key? Well, we have the students present in the assembly. Okay, we have them here during part of the academic year. Well, if we start reconciling those dates, if we start bringing the events of the academic year, what happens in the reality, what is going on with sports, what is going on in the academic life of the high school, what is happening in the world, and then we can make that meaningful to them by making that connection, okay? So if we're able to do that, I think it'll be easier for them to understand themselves as members of that particular congregation and that particular church at large. So that they're not missing the point, that what we do here has meaning, okay? When we reconcile the academic year to the liturgical year, we create a pattern of worship that corresponds to our own calendar, and as much as possible, we observe the universal calendar of the church. Okay, and I think that's central to convey to the students that they belong here, that what we do is important, that the liturgy is central. Okay, so the monthly and even the daily Eucharistic celebrations, which I understand you guys are beginning to get back, okay, they play an important role in that common prayer life of the school. So the celebration is open to all students, regardless of the faith background, religious affiliation, or denomination. And the school, Archbishop MacArthur High School, understands itself as more than a learning institution. It is an ecclesial community of faith whose primary role is the spiritual formation of students. This is in your handbook. This is in the teacher-parent handbook. We profess, this is on the website, I didn't write this. Okay? It is there. You believe it. Okay? The spiritual ministry, I'm quoting from the parent-student handbook. The spiritual ministry of the school offers students the opportunity to witness and commit to their faith, nourish their prayer life, participate in the sacraments, and engage in service to the community in a four-year program of studies. Not just theology studies. I want to emphasize that in every department, the word of God is being proclaimed. You're not necessarily going to read from the Bible, but the discoveries of science. What is happening in social studies in history? How do you bring that to bearing to the reality of God's self-manifestation in the world? Okay. Meaning of the liturgy must be discernible for those who engage in it. How do we make those connections for the student? This is not just the task of the campus minister, or of the theology department, or of the priest, the chaplain of the school. It's the task of everyone. Why do we assemble? Why are biblical texts read? How do these patterns of words and actions, of ritual communication, how do they carry meaning? How do they carry meaning? What are we presenting to them? Okay, how do we let them know that there's already meaning present in the act of gathering as a community? The other day I was in Mr. Future's class, and we were talking about prayer, and then he says, you know, just the fact that we sign, you know, that we make the sign of the cross, that's prayer in itself. Okay, we are gathered in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's the sign of our baptism. That's prayer. Not only is it prayer, but we are making a statement that we are being summoned by God, we're being invited by God, and here we are, we're present and we're responding. So there is meaning already in the time that you gather. So when you call the students down for the liturgy, when you ask the students to pray, there is meaning already inherent in that. So the liturgy is not just a celebration of the Eucharist, but it's everything that we do when that involves prayer of some sort, or a ritual of some sort. So how do we accomplish all of this? Well, what practical solutions do I offer to you? Well, the first thing is, again, I want to emphasize that we are all in this one task, in this one mission. Okay, administrators, teachers, Catholic ministers, students, parents, clergy, celebrants, the preachers, we are all part of the one church. If we have the ability to come together and discuss, to talk about our approach, well, this allows communal participation and other voices to be heard. It should not just be the voice of the theology, it should not just be just the voice of the chaplain, but everyone's voices. We could offer tools for helping the celebrant to prepare homilies, for the music to be prepared appropriately, okay, and to bring in other aspects of the community to function properly. I was telling Mr. Cajon today that I'm helping another organization to plan masses for children, and that they had a mass for children, but when the deacon is going to be ordained priest, came up to preach, he began with a Latin phrase. Okay, not only a Latin phrase, but a philosophical phrase. Ex nihilo nihil fit. And everybody's like, what? And then he went on to explain, you know, that nothing comes from nothing. Okay, and he went on, and I'm like, we're talking to children, this was a mass for the children. So wouldn't it be easier to gather and say, well, these are the readings, invite the children, invite the parents, invite other members of the community to see what the homily could be crafted. What are the readings saying to children? What does it say to young people? What does it say to parents? Okay? So it is not that just one voice speaking to them, but it's an echo of the community. Okay? It is an echo of what is happening in the community. Okay? So this will foster a sense of collaboration and community. But more than that, it can challenge, it can reshape our own theological perspective. Because even as I stand here, I want to make this into a dialogue, because that's what it's about. Remember, the liturgy is that exchange between God and the human person for a mission, okay? For us to be sent off and do something. It's not just my voice, the voice of the preacher, the voice of the celebrant, not the one voice, it's the community. So it has to be a collaborative approach. So I say theology interprets ministry. Well, we should explore if the students benefit from participating in more dynamic celebrations, or it could be the case that maybe they want more traditional liturgies. But until we have some sort of dialogue, conversation, we will never know that. It is not one vision that should reign, but it should be based on what we are hearing from them. There is an image, there's an African image of the tribal chief as a rabbit with the long ears, because the role of the leader is to listen, is to hear what the community is expressing, and then making changes, adaptations, laws that are based on what the chief hears from those members of the community. So, address issues from a liturgical music perspective, from a liturgical aesthetic perspective, the input of students, the experience of teachers, okay, from the insights of preachers. So it's a give and take, people. It's a conversation, it's a dialogue, it is an exchange. We can air our differences, okay, in a collegial collaborative approach. Now, I don't know if you're aware, Pope Francis
is doing this thing called the synodal process. That is a fancy term, the synod of synodality, and that's another fancy word. But it's a process of listening. It's a process of listening. There were actual questions that have gone out to different communities, different parishes, to hear what the people have to say. Now, only 1% of Catholics in the United States participated, okay? But again, that's 1% hearing their voices. And this idea of the synod is not a novel idea in the church. Synod means to go on a journey together. Sin is what end with, and odus, journey. So we are journeying together. They think of the reading from Emmaus when the disciples are fleeing after the death of Jesus and they encounter the risen Lord. They're traveling on the road and they're talking to Jesus. And Jesus is explaining things. I'm like, you know, how can you not get this? How can you not understand this? Jesus says, I hear the frustration in Jesus' voice. But Jesus, again, listens to what they say, what they have to say, the questions, and he answers the questions, and he explains everything else again to them, all over again. And then they meet and they break bread, and that's a liturgical symbol as well. So listening to the needs of others is important before we celebrate, okay? So incorporation of all the actions of the school as well. So how can we make the school a true center of Christian formation? Okay? So my questions to you are, and I'm mindful of the time, and we start today and we have some issues. Now that we have discussed the role of liturgy, how do you think the curricular program of the school can mirror the spiritual program? What aspects of the school's prayer and liturgical life can guide the academic program of the Catholic High School? And how do you see your role as a teacher, administrator, parent, or student in the life of the school? What can we do? What can you do to incorporate it? So how can you bring prayer life and academic life together? Any ideas?
It has to be integral to everything that we do.
Correct.
Starting with just how you set the tone for that classroom.
Correct.
Start with prayer.
Start with prayer.
Of the behaviors, it's very easy to do in an English literature classroom because the Christ figure is everywhere and are the top, and we're free to speak on it.
What are the students reading, and how can I incorporate this? You guys read Night, the book Night, right? And to me, that's a theology book. It's so rich and simple, and the question that it raises. But modeling behavior, I think you hit it on the head with that, because the students need to see every teacher as a minister, as someone modeling a specific type of behavior. As prayer for people, as people of faith. So that happens. I'm going to move on for the sake of time. Okay? So I am going to offer you another idea. The rite of Christian initiation for adults as a model for instruction for what you do here at the Catholic High School. Okay? So the RCIA, the right, if someone comes to the church that wants to be part of the church and has not been baptized, has not been catechized, the person goes through what is called the rite of Christian initiation of adults. And listen to what it says. Adults become participants through the rite of Christian initiation of adults. After hearing Christ proclaim, consciously and freely they seek God and enter the way of faith. Conversion is as the Holy Spirit opens their hearts. So a person approaches and says, I want to be a Catholic, I want to be a Christian. But it's only after that person has heard Christ being proclaimed. What do we do in a Catholic high school if not proclaim Christ? And we have students that want to grow in their faith. So later on I call it not only a conversion model, but a reconversion model, because it is that the students that are here, most of them have been baptized already. Some of them have been confirmed. So they're not neophytes, but they have already been present and part of the Catholic Church of the Christian faith. But we could take that model of the RCIA and utilize it. So the Catholic High School provides academic instruction as a vehicle for continuing conversion.
the religious studies department, campus ministry activities intentionally can be used in the process of ongoing conversion. For example, if instruction begins with the exploration of the faith, I'm saying, well, that the RCIA has what is called the period of evangelization and precatechumen. So take your freshmen and say, well, the freshmen part would be this part, this first part of the RCIA model. Okay, correlate the curriculum to the catechumen period, the period of purification and enlightenment, and even mystagogy. Once you have been initiated, okay, the last period is the period of mystagogy, which means that we are meditating on the faith. So isn't that what we hope those who are seniors to do? Okay, you have been instructed, you have gone through all the process, you have gone through all the rituals, the union ring ceremony, the different retreats, and all from everything, we can incorporate that and say, this is part of a process that you go through in high school. And let's mirror that with the RCIA model. Okay, so the way that I see it, and I could, if you're interested, I can give you a chart where I break this down more concretely. Okay, so it's a process of reconversion, academic program, reconversion, discernment, discovery of God's involvement in the life of students. I was having a conversation with somebody. My BA is in international relations, has something to do with theology. But I was sharing with this person, I remember, maybe because I'm a nerd, I remember walking out of class, and all I could think of was how God is present in the life of nations. I was studying international relations, I was studying politics, and I could very evidently see that God was at work in the world. I didn't go to Catholic University, I went to BYU for my undergraduate degree. And how is it that I saw that? Well, one of my professors did work in Haiti, one of the poorest nations in the hemisphere. And that impacted me so much that I said, well, you know, this man is teaching about international relations, but he's doing work in Haiti. Okay? Another one was of human descent, and he had a very interesting perspective as to what, how the religious center here was so syncretic that it completely transformed not only the faith of the Cuban people, but the culture itself, and the politics. And I was saying, well, religion does play a role. Another professor would often talk about what was happening in the Middle East in my international relations of the Middle East, and the faith, religion was always present. So is it present, is it evident in the classes that we teach it? I believe it is. It just takes a little dialogue, a little bit more intentionality to be present for the students, to model that to the students, to point them in the right direction by the books and the novels that you read, the scientific theories that you engage in the science department, okay? So, again, going back to liturgy, the role of liturgy in conversion. Conversion involves the entire community, not just the theology teacher, not just the preacher, everyone. The spirituality center of the Eucharist, actions, events, activities in the school flow and are oriented towards celebration of the ministry of the faith. Okay? So, I talk about the centrality of the community for proclaiming and responding to celebrating the Christian liturgy, and this is key, that it all should be student-centered. It's not about me, it's not about Father so-and-so, it's not about the principal, it's not about the theology teacher. It should be about the student, okay? The youth bishop, the United States bishop say, preaching must start with a gathered assembly, not with the preacher or the homily itself, okay? Dr. Dinas and I went to the funeral service of one of our mentors some time ago, and the preacher said that when he went to a preaching school, he was told, when you preach a funeral, you're not the priest, you're the person in the casket. And to me, that was such a profound statement. In other words, what you're talking about, you need to connect to the life of that person, okay? In the mystery of the resurrection. Forget about who you are. It's not about you. It's not about what you say. It's not about how well you connect the readings, but it's you are lying in the casket. You as a believer, you as a preacher, you're the one lying in the casket. Well, what the bishops mean is that preaching must begin with a gathered assembly, with the students, with those of us that are present at the celebration. It's about them. It's about how they are seeing, hearing, perceiving what is being said to them, what is being proclaimed to them. So what better way to listen to what they have to say? Okay? To begin with the assembly is to enter into the complexities of their lives, their dreams, their hopes, okay, into the concreteness of culture. What is happening in the life of these students? What's going on? What are their concerns? What are they worried about? And that should be the stuff, not only of what's being preached, but what we're teaching them as well. Because it's not just, again, it's not just a spiritual program, it's what are we doing as teachers? And how are we listening to them? It's about a theology from below that is grounded in the cultural context of the people who comprise the assembly. Okay, it's not a theology from above, well, let me tell you. No, it's what are they telling me, the teacher? What are they telling me, the campus minister? What are they telling me, the preacher? Okay? God's self-communication happens in unexpected places. Again, let's go back to what are we reading? What are we reading in this class? I'm stopping and they're reading Agatha Christie. Okay. Well, what does Agatha Christie, you know, how can we relate that to? I was in another class where they were reading Wuthering Heights. I'm impressed with the reading Wuthering Heights. Wow. Okay. So what? How can we correlate those? Indirectly, at least. Okay. What is the author struggling with? Okay. They were reading not that long ago. Greg Gatsby.
Yes.
Greg Gatsby is an excellent book. What is happening there? So how can we make it relevant to the lives? Preachers, teachers, and liturgical ministers enculturate the message to the world about us. How can we bring that to their life? Okay? All right. So once we have seen how liturgy and academics can go hand in hand, what other aspects of the school could be formed by this relationship? Once a community has prayed and reflected on its own process of conversion, what is, in your opinion, is the next logical step to take as a community? Okay? So remember, the dialogue between God and the human person that prompts us into action. So this takes me to the idea of community service. So I've been talking about the instructional program, the academic instruction, the spiritual life, and now community service. To me, that's what makes a Catholic. That's what makes a high school a Catholic high school. So the demands of the faith are ritualized in liturgy. Okay, explored in the classroom and celebrated by performing action, by doing action. So it's a three-step process. The way that faith is ritualized impacts how that relationship is perceived. So what are we doing to bring the two together? Okay, I had mentioned to you that we should try to reconcile the liturgical calendar to the academic year. World AIDS Day, December 1st. Can we gather to celebrate on that day? And talk about the AIDS crisis that is still around the year or not? Okay. Can we gather for another meaningful day of something that impacts the life of students? I know that back when I was here, we used to gather for September 11th. Okay, I don't know if that still happens. The students were not even born when those events took place. So can we find meaningful dates? Can we, that can bring the two together? The school had recently, the movie night to help one specific person who was in need. Well, how can you bring that to prayer? How can you bring that together with the liturgy, with the prayer, and the spiritual life of the school? I think that's important. So, for most people, liturgy and the concern for social justice seem to be a part. People don't see the immediate connection. Remember how you worship a homeless man on Sunday and ignore one on Monday? People don't see the connection. How can we make it more evident? How can we bring those two together? Okay? So how can we begin to tell students that there is a connection? What we pray about, we also do. We also commit to transforming the world through prayer.
let us pray for prayer's sake. Yes, we need to praise God, and that's fine, and that's necessary. But how do we transform the world? How do we go when we are sent forth? Okay? Leading the believers into action entails highlighting the connection of the celebration of the faith in the classroom and while we're gathered for worship. I see that there are many students who are Eucharistic ministers. Okay? Do they see the role, perhaps, just as distributing communion in for school masses? Or can they take communion to the homebound, to people in hospitals? Can we work that with the parish or with someone? Can students who are Eucharistic ministers, can they bring that? Can they bring communion to a hospital at least once a semester? If not, you know, I would say every time you have mass, but that's just my opinion as an outsider. It is impossible. It's impossible to make that connection more evident. There is a Catholic high school in Ohio that buries homeless veterans. The school as a community, whenever they're contacted, they put the bill, they pay for the burial, they celebrate the mass together for this one homeless veteran. And I said, what a wonderful way to make that connection for the students. Can something like that be done here? Is there a way of connecting what happens in the world and what happens on the altar? So those are some things that we could, I'm open to discussing that with you guys later on. Okay? But more than that, a community of service and reflection. I know that there is, or there used to be a requirement for service hours, where you do the service and then what? How do you reflect on that? How do you reflect on what you did? Not just fulfill the hours. Is there a way for me to reflect? Okay. So, and I say let's call it Christian service, not service hours. I know that service hours are big for college and admittance, but I think we need to push that a little bit more. Can we do Christian service? And what does Christian service entail? What does it look like? What does it look like? And why should we do it? Or call it service learning. What am I doing that is meaningful, and what have I learned about it? It's not just, oh yes, let me go do some, you know, community service, which is good, but how do I reflect on it? Another idea that we could discuss is, can the students gather in a faith sharing group? After they go through the retreats, what happens? How do they continue to live the experience of the retreat? Is it possible that they can gather at some point? I notice that students are very free to gather. I love the fact that I'm not being sarcastic. I love the fact that they gather in the courtyard between classes because they don't have to go to the lockers, I guess. Everything is on the iPad. Everything is on the iPad. So I don't need to go to lockers. So I can, one teacher said they're doing speed dating. And I said, well, it's wonderful. They gather in front of the chapel and just to talk. And to me, again, as someone who's being invited to be here, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Can we bring some Christian aspect to that gathering? Or indirectly, can we make that more of a reflection? And I know we have, well, the statues and the images that we have right at the back of the chapel, they meet in front of the chapel. How can we make that more of a space for them to gather? There's nothing wrong with gathering. That's what it's about. I love the fact that they do. It's such a nice, I don't know if you've been able to appreciate the transition, but I left 10 years ago and now I'm sort of back. And I see that, and what a wonderful surprise. To me, it looks nice. I don't know how you guys feel. Mr. Perez, Mr. Perez?
Yeah.
Well, you like that or no? They're late to class. I know that. Yeah.
They're late to class no matter what.
And that's the problem. But it's such a positive thing for me. I saw them and I was going, oh, no, they just get there. They just in. Again, God invites us to being present. To the other. Even if they're flirting, that's being present for the other. Okay? So I'll be free to discuss that. And again, I took this from your student handbook. Archbishop McCarthy High School affirms its Catholic commitment and finds its source in the tradition and the teachings of the Catholic Church. The spiritual ministry of the school offers students the opportunity to witness and commit to their faith, to nourish their prayer life, and participate in the sacraments.
Is that happening?
Yes.
Can it happen more intentionally?
Yes.
Can we make the connection more evident? I think that's what we're trying to discuss here. Okay? Now, I want to finish with this. Can we recontextualize our ecclesial entity? After the pandemic, I understand that a lot of non-Catholic students started registering in the school. I noticed there are even Muslim students of different faiths, and I think that's wonderful. I think that is wonderful. If you ask experts, we live in a diverse, multicultural, multi-ethnic, multilingual world, but that isn't what Catholic is all about. Isn't that what being Catholic is all about? So it is an opportunity for us as educators to evangelize, not to proselytize, not to convert them to our faith, but to expose them, to invite them, to propose them. And I don't know the French word, but there's a phrase that the bishops of France say that the faith is not imposed, it is proposed. To propose to them, this is what we are, this is who we are. So they're talking about living in a post-Christian world, that society is not Christian anymore. So I see it reflected sometimes in the students at the university and here at the high school. But how are we Catholic? Okay, we know that the word Catholic means universal, but why is it that we are universal? It's universal because of the concern that we have for the whole, for the whole society. Okay? Catholicos, the Greek, Kata is about, and Polus means the whole. We're about everyone. We are about everyone, not just about Catholics. Okay? So the Catholic Church is Catholic because it's universal. Okay? Because it's, we are concerned for every single person. The widow, the orphan, the poor, the immigrant. Okay, and I would say those who are not Christians. We have a genuine concern for them. Okay? And then we need to offer a radical hospitality and what that looks like. Okay? Les Miserables. You've seen them on your Rebecca Rubin's book, you know the play. There's a scene that is my favorite in the whole entire book. I never watched the music, I don't know. But in the book is when Jean Paul John goes to the bishop's house, and the bishop's house says, you know, welcome, you know, he had just, he was in jail for 19 years because he was caught stealing. So he goes to the bishop's house, the bishop feeds him and then offers him a bed so he can stay the night. In the middle of the night, Jean Paul John wakes up and steals the bishop's silver away. Okay? So he leaves at 2 in the morning, the police, bring him back to the bishop's house, and they said, we found this man who stole your silverware. And the bishop says, what? You remember?
No, I gave it to him.
No, I gave it to him. Mm-hmm. And not only that, but you forgot the silver candlesticks. That's radical hospitality. Do we do that to students, for students? Okay, we say, well, it's just a pain in the butt. But how do we welcome them? Okay. How do we offer them more than just, you know, how are we compassionate? Because that's what that scene that I described for you in Israel, that's what it's about. How can we offer radical hospitality? What does it look like in Archbishop McCarthy High School? Okay, do we welcome them, the students that may not be happy? And I'm going to tell you something that really moved me. I was studying a class the other day, and this student approached me, and he just said, can I pray for you? And I said, please, you know, very full price, you pray for me. And he goes, no, right now. And I said, like, you mean like right now? And he goes, yes. And that was his first time meeting me, and then he just, you know, said, you know, dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity to meet Dr. Castillo. I want to pray for him, for his family, and bless him, you know, always. And that was that. And I was, in the 13 years that I studied, that never happened to me. So I felt so welcome. That's why I got hospitality from around the student. I don't know who he is. I would like to thank him.
but I was so deeply moved by that. How are you and I, as educators, doing that for them? That's the question. And these are my final questions. Where does the liturgy fit in the vision of an official entity reimagined? Can a theology or a general academic curriculum that leads to conversion fit into a renewed vision of an official entity? And how can Christian service or service learning be implemented in a diverse, pluralistic post-Christian culture? And I remember Dr. Perlman, in his piece, said that when Archbishop of High School was opening, that the Bishop of Miami went up to him and said, remember, we're here to educate Catholics, and he went like that to him. I would disagree with Archbishop, you know, with all due respect. We're not here to just educate Catholics, we're here to educate and form, like Dr. Diaz is saying, and form people more than just educate Catholics. So how can we be an official entity that radically welcomes everyone, and thus we are a true Catholic entity? Thank you very much. Questions? Any questions that you may have, comments, concerns?
In your study of this issue, have you come across what you would consider model schools, where you researched them and said, this is a school that seems to be doing that or following a certain model?
Specific schools, not necessarily. The one school that I told you that is implementing this aspect of providing a service to the liturgy, which is for the ones that I can find out where that is happening, because they want to extend that to all, to make this a ministry. So I can find out that for you. I don't know if you're open to that idea. Can we bury the homeless better? So, or can we do something like that? I am sure in South Florida there's probably a lot of people who do that. The RCIA as a model, I know of a university that may be doing that. I can find that out for you, but not a Catholic high school. But I think it presents itself as a good model to follow. And my idea, again, I don't know how you feel, but it goes contrary to what the U.S. Bishop proposed with that curriculum framework. It, to me, it's too structured. It's too theologically heavy for students. So that's why I'm saying it's a conversion. It's a reconversion model more than a framework that is very heavy with theology for the students. And especially given the fact that we have such a pluralistic, diverse population of students. So it's how can we make it more of a conversion? So, so I can definitely find out what school that is. I can look back and what they're doing there. The model the university proposes, I took that idea to see if we can implement it in a Catholic high school. But it's following that process of the RCIA, which is what all catechesis is about. It even catechesis in the CD, it follows the RCIA model. So maybe I can provide that information for you. Any other questions, comments?
Given the RCIA model that you were talking about, how long generally would it take to get a school to that?
Well, the idea of the RCIA is that it's a process, not a program. I'm saying we can convert the process into a program, especially since we have semester courses. So pre-catechumenate, catechumenate, mystical, semester one. What am I missing? I'm missing the third step. But is that, and all the steps in the process of the RCIA, the election and all of that could be incorporated into the program as it stands with the freshman retreat, service requirement, the classes that are being taught, and then it moves on all the way to senior where we send them off with graduation. So, how do we invite the alumni back, and how can they, you know, how can we continue the process of mystagogy of still meditating on the sacraments and the reception of the sacraments? How can we continue living that when students have graduated? Another pleasant thing that I see is that so many former students that you're teaching, and there's a connection there. And that's, you know, we're not as good as in House of Finance. Mm-hmm. Now, but we will. We will. Okay, any other questions? Questions, comments?
Okay. For that implementation model, would you start with just the freshmen and then carry them through the 4 years, or would you start with all four?
No, I would start with the freshmen. And correct. If it's about implementing the model of the RCIA, yes. Which, by the way, the RCIA is changing. The name is going to be the order of, you know, it's not going to be RCIA, it's going to be old CIA. The order of Christian. Yeah. Yeah. So I think Spanish is going to be strange because it's RICA in Spanish. It's RICA. It's going to be OICA. OICA. So this one. Some minor trivia. Questions, comments? Thank you very much, then.
Thank you.
Just one last thing.
Yes.
Are you familiar with the Institute of Catholic Liberal Education?
The Institute of Catholic Liberal Education. I have not heard of that.
I'll send you a link.
Okay, perfect.
How
about the RCIA?
I looked into it with a great level of detail, but it's not based on what I heard from you. It sounds like this is what we've been trying to implement at a Catholic school. You see, the Catholicity extended throughout all the subjects.
Correct, yes.
And that's a lot, you may be interested.
Thank you, yes. Because to me, it should be happening already. To me, it's obvious. And then would we incorporate other aspects of the academic program into an RCIA model? Could that happen as well? So, maybe. All right. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks so much for joining us. Hey.